FatBoy Entertainment.
Crowder is a broadcaster and radio host in the US. Stephen, thanks very much for your time this afternoon with us here on Sky News. Let me start by asking, will a travel ban prevent extremism?
Oh, well, that would be a question for Homeland Security. As far as protests or banning Donald Trump from speaking in the UK, I certainly don't think that'll help measures any. I believe in a form of more ideas, of more dialogue, not less. Listen, this isn't a ban. It's important that people understand that there's a difference between a ban and a 90-day moratorium on non-residents in the United States. It's important that people get that right, because then they're going to look at these on a case-by-case basis. You saw that with the green card holders. Every single one of them has now been allowed into the United States. So this is a moratorium put on refugees from 7 specific countries, as laid out by Barack Obama through a bill that he signed into law in 2015. So it's really easy to say, hey, Donald Trump's banning Muslims. No, he's not. And because he's not, of course he should have a spot at the table to speak with your representatives there.
The green card issue, it's been resolved now, but there seems to be a complete lack of planning in the announcement of it, because it initially did apply to anyone who was a green card holder in the US. Should a bit more thought not go into this, considering the topic?
Well, again, I'd hate to correct your language. It didn't apply to anyone who was a green card holder not in the U.S. It applied to green card holders re-entering the United States, going into 7 Islamically war-torn lands where these refugees, anywhere else they've been settled, skyrocketing rape, skyrocketing crime. So it was people who have gone to visit green card holders re-entering the country. Now, was it poorly rolled out? Absolutely. Was it poorly planned? Yeah. Has that been remedied? Yes, but it's also not unconstitutional or unprecedented to include green card holders in a temporary moratorium like this. So I just think it's important that the media get their facts correct. It's not a ban. This was started. These wheels were put in motion by Barack Obama. The green card holders have been allowed into the country, and all of this has happened before, under Barack Obama with the Iraq freeze, under Jimmy Carter in 1980 with the Iran visa freeze. None of this is unprecedented, but everyone wants to protest and throw fits, as you see across the country and from what I'm hearing across the UK, because Donald Trump's the big, mean, bad racist. But no one cared when everyone else has done this. It's happened plenty of times.
Was Barack Obama not responding to a real threat? It was when 2 Iraqi refugees were implicated in a bomb-making in Iraq that targeted US troops. He then requested a slowdown in processing new applications. This is a 90-day ban. It may not be a ban past 90 days, but
Incorrect.
It is a 90-day ban on anyone who lives in those 7 countries coming to the US.
Incorrect. It's not a ban, and Barack Obama selected these 7 countries as well as the freeze during Iraqi immigration. So we need to get that right. It's not a ban. It's like being expelled from school versus suspended. You can be suspended. You can be right back in school. You're expelled. You're out. You never get back in. That language matters, because you hear people out there. You see people getting sucker punched. For example, today at the Portland, Oregon airport, there's more violence carried out against Donald Trump supporters. By the way, I didn't support Donald Trump in the primaries. It's important to note, but I feel compelled to defend him by the horrible behavior that we see on the left, both from the left at large in the United States and, of course, their representatives in the media who use words that are incorrect or misconstrue stories because they don't like Donald Trump. It's not a ban. He's not the first to do this. And these issues are being resolved. We can have a conversation as to whether it was rolled out properly. And that's a conversation I'm willing to have. But it is not a ban. It's a temporary moratorium. And by the way, I don't know that I would have a problem on a more long-term ban from people coming from these countries. As we've seen in the UK, as we've seen in Germany, you have 55% of people in the UK who support a full burqa ban. More in Sweden, less than 26% in the United States, because Brits and people in Europe right now have experienced what's occurred with mass refugee migrants making their way, being settled in the countries where they don't assimilate into the culture, and they have rejected it. A lot of Americans don't know what that kind of a hell looks like. We need to be careful. We need to be bringing in people who respect the Constitution of the United States, the rule of law, and who want to become Americans. This is a temporary moratorium, but I have no problem with banning people who want to come to this country and bring their old laws with them, as opposed to respecting the new.
Did Rudy Giuliani not, and I quote, when he first announced it, he said, Giuliani, Trump asked me how to do a Muslim ban legally.
Yeah, what do you want me to do? Giuliani says stuff.
But
we're talking about law.
That implies
right?
that President Trump did refer to it as a ban.
Well, no, that's what Giuliani said that Trump asked about, right? These aren't official documents. It's not like WikiLeaks. It's not like Hillary Clinton's emails. Giuliani is saying Donald Trump said something. There's a multitude of places where there could have been a breakdown in communication. Where there is not a breakdown in communication, Mr. McCloud, is you and I right now, where we're talking. And I'm clarifying that a temporary moratorium is not a ban. So I don't want to be hooked, be put on the hook for words that Donald Trump may or may not have said because Rudy Giuliani gave an interview on Fox News. I obviously can't respond to that, just like I wouldn't ask you to respond for something Nigel Farage was said to have spoken one time in private. It's not a question I can answer.
Okay, Stephen, where you are, do people love Trump? And we have to admit that he is enacting exactly what he said he'd do to the people who voted for him. Do they love him and are they behind him? Because the protests in the streets in this country and also in the US, there's a lot of people getting out there protesting in the streets. Are the people who backed him as animated about this?
Well, you know, that's a good question. Of course, the violent protests that we see, right? The big difference between the left and the right is you look at the Tea Parties, they actually enacted political change. They primaried their own candidates in their own party versus, you know, you see the Women's March, Occupy Wall Street, the protests at airports where people are getting sucker punched and they're getting bludgeoned. So that's never okay wherever that occurs. I think we could agree on that. I think if you were to hold the election today, Donald Trump would win by a much larger margin. I think most people went into that voting booth and said, well, Donald Trump, he's not Hillary and voted for him. There wasn't a ton of enthusiasm for either candidate. But the left has behaved so poorly in questioning the results, in questioning the legitimacy of the president, in creating all of these violent protests or the Women's March where they were wearing vagina hats on their head and they were talking about LGBTQ, AAIP, and a silent F. And these fringe social justice warrior leftist movements that one time only remained in the deepest, darkest bowels of society have now become the mainstream progressive platform. And so I think you've seen a lot of Americans who didn't necessarily support Donald Trump, who didn't know how to vote, and now they're just loving to watch the meltdown. The left is being shown for the irrational, they can't control their emotions, the uncontrollable, irrational mob that they are, and you're seeing more people, as you see with his approval ratings.
There was no violence reported at any of the women's marches. There was violence reported the night before by some, probably on the left, but there was no violence reported across the world in those women's marches. You're tarring everyone with the same brush.
No, I'm not. I'm talking about wherever leftists congregate, wherever there's a protest, there ends up being violence. So you can talk about Woodstock. You can talk about Woodstock 99. You can talk about the Occupy protests. You can talk about the airport protests. The Women's March was by and large peaceful, and that's why I said the Women's March, where they were wearing vagina hats going up demanding abortion up until the day the head comes out of the birth canal, taxpayer-funded, period, no exception. So I would say that every single one of these protests, whether it's Black Lives Matter, whether it was when, you know, Bernie Sanders, the Occupy kind of Wall Street movement, the Women's March, they're not in touch with everyday Americans who, by the way, would have voted Democrat. Think about this for a second. You have Michigan, the Rust Belt, Midwest, union voters supporting Donald Trump. The left has so far overreached, they've lost Midwestern union voters. You can't side with the vagina hats at the Women's March. You can't side with the Black Lives Matter and these protesters and the cabbies unions until you realize at a certain point, you've lined up against the entire rest of America. And I think it's a really rough time for Democrats in the United States and progressives across the globe. And they better get their act together because you're going to see more people supporting people like Donald Trump who never would have in the first place. I'm so far out of sight. Yeah, that sounds about right. Sounds about right. Let you kill this cup, not my vibe. Be the highlight of my night. Bad boy. Mixed.